I'd like to thank both John Durant and Seth for orchestrating such a beautiful day in so many ways. I'm very pleased to be here, although I'm not a holographer yet. I've been at the Center for Advanced Visual Studies here at MIT for a long time. Last night, Charles Best suggested that in the 70s, it was the only place or one of the few places where an artist could work with scientists, engineers to create new art forms. I think when I started my work, it was the only place where I could have worked, done this work as an artist, but needing the collaboration of scientists, engineers, and physicians. Under the directorship of Otto Pienaar, there were always holographers working at the center. Artists like Harriet Kasdan Silver, Dieter Jung, Sally Weber, Don Thornton, Eric Begleiter, Betsy Connors, just to name a few. When I was acting director of the center for a couple of years, Paula Dawson and Susan Gamble came. Under Steve Benton's directorship, the Vision Group was established. Steve was very much an active, vital part of the Vision Group. I wish I could have the chance to show him our latest invention, which I'll talk about a little later, the Seeing Machine camera. I am visually challenged. I have no useful vision in my right eye, persistently no useful vision. I do have the ability to recognize hand waving at a very close distance. In my left eye, my vision vacillates from less than hand waving to as much as 2100. I don't usually talk about my visual acuity because it's only one way of seeing, but I thought that might alleviate some questions later. With my limited sight, I think I can perceive holographic space. I think I can perceive holographic space better than the space I navigate through or try to navigate through each day, and better than other representations of space in other media. I don't know why this is true. Maybe some of you will have an idea. I do imagine at some day turning my retina prints into holograms. As a matter of fact, I've spoken at length with Dieter Jung about how we might do this. On the other hand, I can also imagine incorporating holo video into my seeing machines. Steve Benton and I had some initial conversations about that several years ago. People often ask me to tell them what I don't see. Today I'm going to talk about what I do see and my attempts as an artist to visualize, interpret, communicate, and maybe even to celebrate my disintegrating vision. I'm also going to talk a little bit about the seeing machines, which we've developed for people with little or no sight. It's these machines that have enabled me to work as a visual artist. I think 25 years ago, I wrote a poem called Disappearance. Things are disappearing, branches from trees, pieces of words, lines in faces. At least 20 years ago, I had no vision in either eye, and my ophthalmologist sent me to the Scapin's Eye Research Institute so they could see if I had any functioning retina. Technicians projected images, test figures, onto my retinas using a medical tool, a device called a scanning laser ophthalmoscope, a device for visualizing the retina so physicians could see what's wrong with it. I could see those stick figures, and I asked if they could write a word. They wrote the word sun, and it was the first word I'd seen for a long time. Almost immediately, I got in touch with the man who invented the machine, Robert Webb, and we began a collaboration that is still ongoing. He's an important part of the vision group. I created visual experiences, visual images that I could see through the scanning laser ophthalmoscope. And Rob's task was to adapt the machine so that I could see these visual experiences. At this time, I worked with artists at the Center for Advanced Visual Studies. One artist I worked with, I know is here today, Keiko Prince, who we did a performance in which she appeared to paint with calligraphy directly onto my retina, and that was my feeling. I had the feeling that she was, in fact, painting on my retina. Maybe this will become clearer as I show you an excerpt of a video from a performance that Seth Riskin and I did called Eye Dance. We built a small white cube, and there were projections of my looking retina on one of the walls of the cube. Seth did a light dance inside the cube that responded to the images of my looking retina. One beautiful thing about the SLO, the scanning laser ophthalmoscope, is that it has an output, so you can see the retina looking at whatever image is the input that is it's being given to look at. So I was looking at Seth's light dance as he was looking at my retina. Could we start the tape? Thanks. I hope it's cued to the right place. But yeah, and so I could actually see the light ballet or the play of light as Seth was doing his light dance. For me, this was a beautiful, beautiful experience. The reason I wear a hat is because so fast, light spilling into my eyes becomes just white glare, and that's all I see. But in this case, I could see the articulated light from Seth's dance. Okay, thanks. It's during this time I became very aware of the space between the front of my eye and the back of my eye. It seemed to be that space that was active, that was was this very beautiful, private kind of space in which art could happen. I mentioned maybe I didn't mention the retina prints yet. I was fascinated by the output of the scanning laser ophthalmoscope, which enabled me, when I had enough vision, to see a looking retina. It also enabled other people to see my retina looking. Well, that was great, and yet it said very, very little about what I was seeing with my blind eye. I'm now going to show you a series of retina prints. These retina prints always start with the image of the looking retina. Sometimes I use my retina, sometimes I use somebody else's retina. Other people's retinas are generally more photogenic than mine, so I do use them. This is, I think, the first retina print I made. It's called Frog Pond. Otto and I live on a farm, and there's a frog pond on the farm. All summer, we hear the bullfrogs, but I'd never seen a bullfrog. A photographer came, and I asked him to take pictures of the bullfrog, which I then looked at through the scanning laser ophthalmoscope with my blind eye. And I saw the frog, and I saw the frog's eye. Sometimes this retina print reminds me of Betsy Connor's early work called, I think, Slot Opera. Next. This is a retina print of Sophia Serafina at 4 weeks on her father's retina. Her father is Seth, and this is his retina. However, it's really, it reflects my way of seeing Sophia. Next. One of the visual experiences, or set of visual experiences, I created for the scanning laser ophthalmoscope was a visual language. I took all basic English nouns and verbs of 3 or 4 letters and made them into word images, combinations of letters and pictures. I did this so that the words would be easier to read. When most of you read across, when most of you read a word, you read across the tops of the letters. Well, for me, I have to read up and down and around each letter. So when I get to the end of a very short word, I need to begin again to make sure I remember everything correctly. Hence this word door. When I replace the two O's with an image of a door, I can then see the D and the R and the image probably as fast as you can. And the two O's in the middle don't set up any kind of interference pattern so that the whole word becomes kind of wiped out because I can't see it. This particular retina print is called Door on Sabrina's Retina. Next. When we were in Kyoto, I'd heard about the wandering monk with little Buddhas coming out of its mouth. I could hardly wait to see this. I don't know why I thought I could see it. But Otto and I went to see it, and I got a postcard. Of course, I couldn't see the little Buddhas. I could barely see them, the monk. But through the scanning laser ophthalmoscope, with my blind eye, I was able to see the Buddhas. Next. In Murano, in Italy, there is in the cathedral a blue virgin floating in gold space. To me, it was almost like a hologram. I saw the blue space floating until I actually took a picture of it myself and then looked at it later through the scanning laser ophthalmoscope. This is the Murano Virgin on my retina. Next. This retina print is called Descent, and I think it's meant to communicate the terror of steps, of going down. Next. There's a story behind this retina print called Hornet's Nest. In the summer, we have blooming hydrangea. And I went out to pick a bouquet of blooming hydrangea. Only the best hydrangea turned out to be a hornet's nest. Somebody caught me just in time before I got stung, and I later, the hornet's nest was preserved, and I looked at it through the scanning laser ophthalmoscope, and this is the retina print called Hornet's Nest. Next. Otto did a sky event a few years ago in Siena on Piazza del Campo, and I photographed his sky event called Red Horse. At the time, I had about the same kind of vision I have in my left eye. Of course, I don't see the camera, the image on the camera, so I literally shoot blindly, and then looked at the experience later through the seeing machine. These next three are Red Horse retina images. Next. Okay. This is quite a recent retina print called Night Blooming Cirrus by Day. The night blooming cirrus, maybe some of you know, blooms from 8 o'clock in the evening until 3 o'clock in the morning. Over one night, that's it. Next. This is the most recent retina print I've done, called Old Woman. There was an exhibition, some of you may have read about it, in Venice a couple years ago called Temple, in Palazzo Fortuny. And the man who created the exhibition actually allowed me to touch this piece of artwork and to go all around it and photograph it. So I took a lot of photographs, and this is almost like a haptic retina print. It's my image of this sculpture. Just don't want to fall off this. Okay, that's all I have left. The seeing machines that developed after the scanning laser ophthalmoscope were initially a black and white seeing machine that used LEDs instead of laser. And we tested it at Joslin Clinic Beetham Eye Unit with a grant from NASA. The black and white seeing machine, actually, while Steve was there as part of the vision group, it was then that we came up with this, was of course more portable than the scanning laser ophthalmoscope. It was a desktop version, and it was far cheaper. The scanning laser ophthalmoscope costs well over $100,000, but this machine we could build for $4,000. The image was very clear through the scanning, the black and white seeing machine, perhaps clearer than through the scanning laser ophthalmoscope. I still needed assistance to use it. We tested it using my visual language and a virtual architectural environment, which people navigated with a joystick. The results were very promising and led to a color seeing machine, which didn't work well at all, and this current model, which I'm very happy with. This is a seeing machine camera. And it works, I think, very well. It's very simple. I can use it alone, by myself. I don't need any help. So I can take pictures like I write poems now, alone. We've just received Committee on the Use of Human Subjects experimentally. We've just received the approval to test it. And so we'll be testing it at the Joslin Diabetes Center Eye Research Institute, probably starting next month. This machine can be built for under $500, including the camera and its color. I just want to show you a few photographs that I've taken using this machine. I think you'll see that the photographs have, some of them at least, a spatial quality. The first face of a friend. I don't see anybody's faces. Those of you who know me know I don't recognize you. But with this camera, I can see the expression in the eyes, the expression in the mouth. Next. A detail which shows, I think, my way of seeing spatially. Next. This machine can be used to look at artworks and taken to museums to look at art in museums. Next. Details from a walk. Next. The spatial quality begins to reappear in my photographs. Clouds moving. I couldn't see those before. Next. A mountain in the distance. This happens to be Mount Wachusett. It's the first time I've seen Mount Wachusett. Next. And the last picture of a river at our farm. And I think this, again, has some sense of depth. Because of my visual challenge, I'm very aware of haptic exploration. I'm also aware that a lot of visual enjoyment depends on being able to see space. I think that in the future, work that's instrumentarium for people who are blind or almost blind needs to think a little bit about not only about both haptics and possibly holography as part of creating enjoyable visual experiences for people who are blind. Thanks, and if there are questions, I could ask.
It's still plugged in there.
Okay. Do we have any questions? Just don't move. Jeff Odner. I see the camera and I see the input, the camera output going into the white box. How mm-hmm. does that get into the retina?
There's an LCD screen in the box and LEDs. The LEDs have replaced the laser, and it's basically a Maxwellian view system so that the image travels to a point rather than spreading out onto the whole retina. So it goes to the point of your retina that's still functioning if you have just even a small, for example, with my right eye, I have just a small tag of active retina in the close periphery. And I use that piece of peripheral vision as my central or foveal vision. Yeah, you put it right up to your eye. Yeah. I wish it's a little too, it's not quite robust enough to pass around, I'm afraid. But if somebody's interested in seeing it later, it's here with me.
I'm just curious if you can get a similar effect, not quite as detailed, using a pinhole occluder.
We don't use one. It's a good question. It's a question that technically I don't know the answer to. Although I don't, you know, I forgot to mention. And I don't know if any of my collaborators are here, but I've collaborated with scientists, engineers, physicians, artists, and students at both MIT and Harvard for a long time, especially the Europe program here at MIT, the Undergraduate Research Opportunities Program, has been really important to me, providing students that have essentially been the backbone of this work. Yifei Wu actually has done a lot of work on developing this camera. I don't know if she's here. She may not be here today. Yifei could answer that question perhaps better than I.
Elizabeth, may I ask you a question, and that is, mm-hmm. What can you imagine of the overlap between new possibilities in holography and what your work is about? Can you see an opportunity for bringing them together in a way that could carry your work forward for you and for others?
It's easiest for me to answer that as an artist. I can definitely see using holography to do a new kind of moving retina print that really gives an immersive quality to my kind of vision and could really engage you, I think, in terms of your whole being in what my kind of vision's like. I know that there are relationships between the scanning laser ophthalmoscope system and probably even this system and holographic video. And I just don't know how useful it could be, but I'm sure it would be. Michael Bove could probably answer that a lot better than I.
One question in my mind, and I don't know enough about the field to answer it, but I wonder if someone here does, and that is, might it be possible to present stereo information to one retina, or maybe two areas within one retina, and have stereo experience come out of it? All right. If someone has the answer, I'd be great. But we'll have to wrap it up in 1 second and move on. Hi, Mark.
I think very simply, having experimented this last year or so with very simple creation of animated GIFs where the left image and the right image, I call them shaky grams. Maybe there's another official name for it, but you take a stereogram, you overlap them, and you oscillate them at about a tenth of a second each, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And amazingly enough, we have the ability to create some kind of discernment of depth in 3D, even though you could close one eye and look at it.
You know, that's interesting, and I'd really like to try that. I think something that people might not take into consideration is that very bad seeing is also very slow seeing. And I don't know whether that would be affected.
All right, well, I'm afraid we must move on. But thank you very much, Elizabeth. Oh, you'll take it down.